episode 8 of season 17. I'm Lyle Troxell, and with me is Mr. Miles Elam.
How's it going?
Good. Let's start off by a little bit of follow-up from last week. We talked way too much about Uber and how bad they are. I've stopped using Uber now after reading more about that whole incident. And I'm curious to see if the company tries to redeem itself. But you have new Uber stories for today.
Google has been an investor in Uber for a while. They were a fairly early investor, as a matter of fact. Turns out that Google and their self-driving car outfit, which is called Waymo.
Waymo is the self-driving car.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Or is the name of the company that makes the Google self-driving car initiative.
Right. Is it Waymo because that's the way you go, the Waymo?
I don't know why it's called that.
Mm-hmm.
But it's under Alphabet, so it's not really Google. They are suing Uber, which is an odd thing to do to a company that you have a large investment in. It turns out that a former executive, a former engineer that worked for what would become Waymo, and a few other individuals there stole information on their way out the door and told people that they were doing such a thing, like going off and going to start their own company or going to work on a new company doing this. And so when Waymo was working with a supplier, quite by accident, they sent an email to Waymo that wasn't intended for them.
The supplier did?
Yes. With schematics. At which point, folks at Waymo looked at it and went, wait a second. Those schematics weren't intended for us, but they look conspicuously like our stuff. And after looking at it a little further.
So they got a copy of schematics of what Uber's group was doing.
Fairly detailed ones where they could see, wait, this is our stuff. This is not just general, you know, items. And so it did look like industrial espionage, and so or corporate espionage, mm-hmm. I should say. And so they sued Uber, who has had no end of bad news of late.
They have not. That's true. You know, when I worked in the radio broadcast industry, the company I worked for, Inovonix, Inc., Jim, who's the CEO and founder of the company, was looking at schematics as well. It's actually kind of common in the pro space to provide the schematics of designs because your engineers want to know what's going on, right? And also, you need to be able to fix things in the field.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you'd sell a unit, and then most of the time, you'd actually provide a manual. So we'd provide a manual to the equipment we had. These are like broadcast chain stuff, audio processing stuff. And we'd provide the schematics so that somebody could go and, you know, replace a chip in the field without having to call us if they needed to do that and understand how the system was working. And some competitor, I don't even call who the competitor was, we saw one of their schematics, and it was a copy of Jim's schematic. I mean, it was just the same thing. I mean, relayed out, but the schematics were the same. Same resistor values, same capacitor values, the same in every way. And so there was this idea that, well, he could sue them, obviously, and potentially make some money. But there's a lot of, there's a whole business in suing. And when you're a small company with like 12 employees or something like that, going into a lawsuit is a completely different chain, you know, thing to do. And additionally, what would actually happen, the person would, you know, potentially some part of the revenue, but the company wasn't that successful. Like, it might not even make sense. So what he did instead is he took an ad out in one of the trade magazines with a printed schematic of ours and a printed schematic of the competitors and a picture of himself as a young boy on top of his equipment.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually Photoshopped, this was one of the earliest Photoshop things I did, was I made this little young child of the guy that I worked for, Jim, on top of one of our new piece of equipment. And, you know, saying, you know, he's been first tons of times. It's kind of like mm-hmm. a trash against the company. And it was a good way of doing it because it did produce a lot of stir. And in the industry that's small enough like that, all the engineers pretty quickly know what's going on. So they knew that this other company had stole designs from us, and it actually benefited us, and no lawsuit. So pretty smart way to handle it. But I guess Waymo decided to, they have got the entire Google or Alphabet company behind with lots of lawyers, so suing is not even a question.
Well, they also approached them and talked about it, but it was also pretty clear cut. And this is an area where there is a great deal of competition, not just within Silicon Valley, but also within the established car makers are
sure.
moving further and further into the autonomous car sphere. And also with the intent that you have someone who was working at another company, getting paid well, and they were, it wasn't a accidental, oh, I'm using some knowledge that I had before. They specifically copied data off on their way out the door.
Right, because the schematic, of course, in that situation is not going to be in the engineer's mind. They're not going to reproduce it completely. They probably had a copy.
Well, they actually have a technical copy, a log, saying that they did this.
Oh, man,
so,
so bad.
It was very much in that realm of, we got to do.
Well, how is Uber's self-driving project going?
Not as well as they'd like. They were already shut down from having a pilot program in San Francisco. California DMV shut them down, saying, hey, you're not giving us enough data to say that you're safe.
Mm.
And
has the California DMV said yes to other self-driving? They've said yes to Tesla.
Yes,
and to...
Yes, they've given a license. Not Tesla. Tesla, or I mean,
different
for... Yeah, it's
true.
Not... We're talking about full autonomous vehicles where there is no input from a person and going through crowded streets. So these are things that the Google self-driving vehicle has...
The Waymo.
Waymo,
Waymo, sorry.
Has been given a license for. And they did. They had to go to the DMV and get a registration for that. And one of the conditions of doing that registration is that you have to report every incident that has ever occurred in your testing.
Right.
And Uber didn't want to do that. It's one of the reasons why California DMV said, no, you're cut off. You're not doing it.
You're not being transparent in the problems you're running into, so we can't trust that you'll be transparent if something serious occurs.
Right. And in fact, the Uber self-driving vehicle did in fact run a red light on video. Uber claimed it was human error. It wasn't the fault of the vehicle as a bid to try to make sure that they could still get their self-driving car in there. Turns out that internal documents have shown that Uber self-driving cars ran 6 red lights in a short span of time.
I see.
And in many of those times, because they were just testing them out, there is a human driver in them. The human driver saw it and slammed on the brakes to stop it. Not before it entered the crosswalk, you know,
or running past red light.
Yeah, or past the,
Oh, my God. Well, I mean, that's obvious fail. Like,
yeah.
Self-driving car 101 must stop at red lights.
Must not run red lights, yes. Yeah. And we understand that things are a work in progress, but with regard to engineering, and this harkens to mind when I was making a post on Facebook about... Mm. A bridge in Big Sur that was closed down due to storm damage. But an important thing about that was the bridge did not fall down. The bridge had a bunch of cracks and some sagging, and that led authorities to say, hey, this is no longer safe. But it did not send anyone plunging into a ravine or
right.
into the ocean.
And a safe fail, if you will.
Right.
A non-catastrophic fail.
Right. And that is where... I think people don't necessarily give enough recognition to engineers, and I don't mean necessarily software engineers, although there are some areas where software does have does affect human life. But many times as programmers, we're kind of like, the worst that happens is, oh no, your hard drive is reformatted or something like that. But the fact that you're now getting into the sphere where it will affect human life,
mm-hmm.
where then the true calling of engineer, what engineer used to mean prior to 1990, really comes to the fore, that you have to be responsible for the fact that you could cause, real bodily harm.
Yeah.
And Uber was still treating it like software bugs.
Right. Not acceptable if they're trying to put the vehicles on the streets. So, again, DMV is not stopping them completely. They're just saying you can't do that on public streets.
Well, for all intents and purposes, California DMV really did shut them down. So, they had
well,
the only way to go.
Doesn't shut down their research. right? It shuts down their ability to be on the open road.
Well, they didn't shut down.
You can keep on trying to make block bridges if you want, but you can't put bridges in the public space. It's the kind of same kind of thing, right? Like,
or rather, Uber said, "Hey, we're going to go to Arizona instead," and Arizona has actually done a non-committal. Hey, we're just going to try to make sure we make the best of it. Kind of response seemed very much a we want to be pro-business, but we don't want to actually be in show real support for them publicly.
Yeah. Did you want to cover anything else about Uber being kind of slimy, or are we kind of good with that?
I think we've covered Uber enough.
If there's
we
more
covered
news,
them enough we'll talk, last week.
Yeah. So. There's more news about them, of course, we'll bring it up again. Well, let's move on to something a little more amazing and cool, and that is that pigeons. You know pigeons, right? You don't think of pigeons as very smart. But new research shows that they can learn to read English words.
Excuse me?
Oh, yeah. Pigeons definitely are in a space where I think of them as relatively unintelligent. At the same time, carrier pigeons, you know, they define communication for a certain period of time. I mean, there's an amazing quality about birds. And in general, birds have a different process of development of thought than of mammals. And so they're quite different in a lot of ways. Anyways.
And they can sleep with half their brain asleep.
They can fly and sleep? Is that why they can sleep with half their brain asleep?
When they sleep?
Yeah.
It's usually only half of a hemisphere that is asleep. They get kind of dozy. Same thing happens with dolphins.
I didn't know that. Is that so they can continue functioning?
Yes, and watch out for predators, yes.
That's really cool. So the article is published...
Sorry for that little segue.
That's fine. The article is published in PNAS. It's a magazine about nature and such. And the story is talking about taking... 18 birds, the brightest of the pigeons they could figure out, and over 8 months of training in advanced pigeon classes, they were taught to distinguish four-letter words from non-words. An example of this would be the word very, V-E-R-Y, they would understand, and the word V-R-E-Y, they would understand not to be correct. So just
they would recognize as being the one that gives them a treat as opposed to the one that doesn't. But
in no way are we talking about comprehension of the word very, but that they can recognize four letters next to each other, even though they're very similar. So this is about pattern recognition. And of course, you'd understand that birds have to do that. Like they're flying quickly. Mm-hmm. They've got to have amazing visual acuity to do what they do. In any case, they were able to train some of these birds from between 26 to 58 different words, and kind of amazing, I have to say. I mean, that's exciting. If this is outdoing what apes have been able to do. We haven't been able to train baboons and other primates to be able to do this kind of character recognition. And the thing that's interesting is that human beings, you know, it's only like 54,000 years ago that we have any representation that there was complicated language in written form. We probably had language for a long time prior to 4,000 years ago. But prior to that...
54,000? Really?
5,400. Excuse me.
Okay. I was about to say.
That was... 5,000. A little over 5,000 years ago, we didn't have any written form. Or one way to say that, of course, is that we don't have any record of us having any written form, right? I mean, maybe we just did it in different ways. But that means that we haven't evolved written language. Like the ability to read is not an evolved trait in the sense that at one point we had it and at one point we didn't have it. And there wasn't a... you know, progression of more complicated structures. So the question is, how are we able to read so effectively? And the concept about that is that we're taking advantage of our visual representation of words. What we're doing is, when you sound out words, that's one thing. That's learning the alphabet, learning phonemes and stuff. But when you see a large word and it immediately means what it means, like the word pigeon, when you see that, the reading, when I say reading, what I mean is you recognize the word pigeon as a bird. Immediately. And there's no comprehension that it starts with a P and so on. It's not individual sets, it's a word. That is actually what it's probably doing is taking that same word and mapping it to the imagery we have of a pigeon, for example. Mm-hmm. So nouns are a relatively simple way of conceptualizing why we can do that. And we do the same thing effectively. We're taking advantage of our ability to map or to pattern recognizers and recognizing patterns that match to other systems and hooking them up in our brain. So it's like a side, reading's a kind of a side effect of our pattern matching capability, or that's how the theory goes.
So I have a question for you.
Mm.
Do you think that the pigeon could spell better than you?
I knew when I said very and very and it transverses those two middle words that you would say that to me. Yeah, I think the pigeon couldn't because it doesn't have fingers. Ah, gotcha. any case, pretty cool. Pigeons reading.
Indeed. On a completely unrelated note, with regard to robots taking over people's jobs, we covered this at length last episode. A poll was put forward asking Americans, what do you think about robots taking everyone's job? So that conversation we had. You know,
we've been having for a while. So the idea of robots taking over people's jobs. So Americans were asked, what do you mean what were they asked specifically? Like, what do you think about it? Or they asked, do you feel comfortable that robots will take
over? Well, NBC was asking, or CNBC, was asking people, do you feel that your job is in danger? Do you feel that other people's job is in danger?
Okay, that's two questions. Uh-huh.
Yes. And by and large, Americans believe that robots are going to take other people's jobs.
Okay.
But they believe that theirs is safe.
So robot, my job is not in danger from robots being taken over, but
I believe
other
that my
jobs,
job is such that a robot could not do it.
That harkens back to my response about programming when you said that eventually machines will be able to program. I said, no. You're right, that when we have deep knowledge on a skill set, we understand the complexities enough to assess whether a robot could do it, we probably would overestimate its complexity, and potentially other people's jobs underestimate its complexity. And I think I've seen this in life where I go, like, what does that person do all day? You know, just because you're not aware what they're doing doesn't mean they're not working hard. Interesting. So does that mean that... I wonder what that means exactly.
Well, there's an Oxford University study from 2013 that estimates that 47% of U.S. jobs will be replaced by robots and other forms of automation in the next 10 to 20 years.
I have heard that stat before.
That would be a disruptive change.
It would be.
And so, yeah, there's a lot of programmers who go like, oh, that'll never happen to me.
I think it's interesting. The last month, as you and I have talked about robots and artificial intelligence stuff, we have started to compound the concept of robots taking over jobs with AI taking over jobs. I don't really see a separation anymore. There are jobs that can be done by machines. Whether they're physical or intellectual only, they still can be done.
Right. I think of
I just kind of pushed them together in my mind. I don't think of a separation anymore.
Yeah, I think of the movie Ghost in the Shell.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a scene in there where you see data entry people, as it were, or people who are...
This is an animated show?
Yes. Yeah, yes. Okay. Not the movie that was coming out
soon.
Yeah, but
has come out.
I don't know.
Whatever. Anyway, Ghost in the Shell, original Japanese animated movie.
Right. Person came in, had to use the keyboard, and he holds out his hands, and they split apart into
the hands or the keyboards.
The hands.
Their hands. Oh yes. Oh yes. Gosh, that was great imagery. I remember this.
So you have like 10 fingers, and suddenly the 10 fingers split off to be 50. Finger little digits that who then split off again. You end up with 100 different pieces, and they are all typing at this furious pace.
Right.
And it's funny because it doesn't seem like that would be how it turns out at all. It seems like a slow interface to the whole thing. Why not just plug right in?
It's an interesting concept. Like prior to the ways we have enhanced our ability to communicate with machines, it does make sense that if you can type fast, then having four hands makes typing faster. Like that's the interface. Interesting,
right? And at the same time, on the flip side, we always laughed about how in Star Wars, R2-D2 couldn't tell the difference between a communication port and a power jack.
Who couldn't?
R2-D2. Remember in the original movies?
Oh, because he gets fried.
Yes. He plugs it in Cloud City's. Yeah.
Well, he was designed to be on top of a ship. I mean,
right. But the idea that the port was the same, the power port and the data port, and like, what? That doesn't make any sense. And then we have USB-C. So the things that we were thinking like, oh, that would never happen, have happened. And the ways that we predicted would happen, yeah, that doesn't seem
And last
like,
week you covered like a USB device that would fry R2-D2 if he plugged into it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I was chatting with family and friends over this last week. I've spent a lot of time with family, and we talked about artificial intelligence and robots taking over jobs. And someone brought up, well, picking strawberries won't be replaced by robots. And I said, we actually covered a story of it. I think it was Stanford, but I'm not sure exactly who it was, that made a robot that could pick strawberries. And that already exists. We already have robots that can pick strawberries from the field, and they do a good job of it.
Well,
they do it very, very slowly.
Yeah, but and they do bruise the fruit more than human beings do.
Well, I thought the story we covered actually was about a suction cup thing that was actually doing a really good job of protecting the fruit. Potentially solvable, but those are really slow, and of course you have to have a track. I mean, financially, it makes no sense to do that right now. But at some point, it probably will.
Yes.
Right? It's not actually an engineering feat. It's a financial feat. And if...
Well, a little bit of column A, a little bit of column B.
Yeah. But I mean I would assume that right now you could produce a machine that would do it. I mean, it might have to have something that has like a little injector and takes a sample of the fruit to find out its sweetness factor, or a little sniffer that tells how much glucose is in it. I mean, there's qualities that a human being can do that's like beyond what most machines can do. My laptop couldn't do it.
Yeah, I don't know. When I pick fruit, at least at my house on my very small scale, the things that I notice are color. I mean, that's the immediate
color, absolutely.
How ripe is the fruit? You look at the color.
Pressure.
And tactile.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the smell, because I can't smell to distinguish a specific fruit.
Well, I think what's
from
fascinating,
the rest of them.
Fruit picking is this great example of, we are evolutionally designed, if you will, to be good at picking fruit. Like, that is something that actually we do, like, more than reading. You might think you're a really amazing reader. Mm-hmm. Your whole brain system is good at picking fruit.
Yeah,
that's amazing.
Many primates actually have this as a differentiator from many other mammals.
Right,
and that we have color vision, so we are able to see this aspect to fruit. That
yeah, I mean, a dog must can't, a yeah, dog can't pick fruit.
Has to smell it first.
Right. Yeah. Actually, maybe it could do it with the smell. But it's interesting that we, this quality that not all of us have. At the same time, if somebody that's not familiar with picking fruit at all, a human being. An average human being, was put in a situation where they had to choose good fruit, after like a day and a half, they'd be really good at it. Because they have all the capabilities, they just maybe haven't learned them, mm-hmm. right? So it's neat to see that for us it's simple, for our machines it's complex. But my point really was that this is a great example of the conceptual complexity of it is not extremely great, right? Pressure, color, size... Those things are all things machines can do right now. We have mm-hmm. software that can detect whether it's a dog or a cat on mm-hmm. one leg or three, right? So we have a lot of that capability already. It's really just about putting in the infrastructure. And why bother? Humans are relatively inexpensive comparatively to these machines out in the fields.
Unless the immigration regulations that...
Well, this is why this came up at some level, right? Yeah. I mean, it potentially could get more viable to build machines that could do this kind of thing. Anyway, I think it's inevitable, but I really think it's fascinating that we've got rid of this concept of separation of robot from AI.
I was driving the other day when this image came into my head of robots picking produce. And one of that images that came up of what that robot would look like, I suddenly had an image of the robots that were tending the fields of human beings connected to the Matrix.
Yeah.
Like that would picking the humans.
Octopus kind of looking things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That would like walk on 10 limbs and grab and...
Right. Well, yeah, of course, a robot that was really efficient in this sort and wouldn't interact with the Earth very much would move all over the field and would have a large storage facility above the field.
So I have to say, the imagery...
It pretty much is one of those things.
The image in my head gave me a few chills.
The willies?
And it does make me wonder if in the future, when they come to fruition, because they will...
so they will. That's true.
Because that there will be people, I believe, that will say, no, I want something that only human beings are involved in the chain as a conceptual view.
Well,
in much
like,
the same way that people say I'm against GMOs.
Like, right. As much,
much the same ideology.
Or I want it close to home. You know, I want it 100 miles of me. Like that same kind of concept where... I want to invest a bit in the lack of industrialization of the food system. Yeah, there will be those people. And the people that have gardens.
Yeah. And then there's going to be the folks that want to have a home garden and they don't want to actually get dirty. And so they set up this robot that's solar powered that does, you know, all of their weeding and picking for them.
Scary, sad. Let's go ahead and talk about SHA-1.
SHA-1 is a hash algorithm. Simple hash algorithm is what it stands for. The ability to take an input, whether it be text or a binary.
I didn't know SHA stood for simple hash algorithm.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Okay, sorry.
And it's not the original name of the algorithm. SHA-1, it was a competition where you had multiple algorithms trying to go for the one algorithm that had been vetted and evaluated by researchers and for general use so that everyone could look and see this is the one that's been vetted as being the best overall so that everyone in industry can use it.
And so it then got the moniker SHA-1.
Exactly.
Okay.
Same thing happened with SHA-3, SHA-256.
SHA-25 I saw. So there's a lot of these for some reason. Maybe it was 256 and I just saw a misprint.
Yeah, I think 256. And there's a SHA-512 as well. And
so a hashing algorithm means that what is a hash? Like, try to define that for us.
Well, it is a way to if you have a large volume of text or a movie, which would be a large binary, you want a way to get a signature from that.
A unique thing from it.
Right, because to verify that, let's say you want to make sure that you got the movie that you downloaded is actually the movie that you wanted.
Okay.
You wouldn't download it and then go, okay, now I want to check byte for byte. Is this the same thing that's on the server?
Because that's downloading it again.
That's downloading it again. So what you
do is, theoretically, during the transport or something, something could have changed. One bit could have been modified. And you have the same size file and you know, the system that was downloading it said, this is how big it is and here are the bits. So theoretically, it's fine, but you don't really know unless you can check somehow.
Right. So instead, you make a signature, and that is what a hash is. And it can be used for a variety of tasks, and we'll cover that in a little bit. But the idea being that if you have this sequence of bits for this length it's going to come up with this particular signature. And if you download that movie and you run that same algorithm again on your copy and you come up with the same signature, you know that those two are the same, even though you haven't downloaded it more than once.
You actually see on websites that you can download software, sometimes you'll see right next to it a little, you know, 20-character thing, a little hash.
Mm-hmm.
And what this basically means is when you download this file, run it against SHA-1, you should get a number that's the same as this number. And when I say number, it's not really a number because it is a large number, actually. But we translate that normally.
Yeah, it's a 160-bit number, but because we don't really handle
160 bits?
Yeah, numbers that are that large, we convert that to text. And just having that as a decimal isn't really usable for people.
How do we convert that to text, by the way?
It's converted to a hexadecimal, to base 64.
It's just a hexadecimal number of the same number.
Right.
Right.
The idea being that if you do decimal, in other words, base 10 system, how we do it, 10, 100, 1,000, you know, 10,000.
And you only have the digits 0 through 9. Those are the digits you have worked
right.
with.
Right. That doesn't 10. Map well to a binary system, which is a bunch of ones and zeros, which was going to be a power of 2 rather than a power of 10.
Mm-hmm.
And so with the power of 2s, you're looking at 1,024, 2,048, 4,096. These are numbers that are not immediately intuitive to human beings, but are to computers. So we kind of shake on it and do a middle ground, which is base 16. So instead of going 0 to 9, you go 0 to 9, A, B, C, D, E, F. And that way, the number, as it were, in hexadecimal will always map up bit for bit with the decimal number that we have.
Because two times 2 is 4, and four is
2,
8.
4, 8, 16, 32,
so
16
is a pattern matching, or matches the power of 2, unlike 10.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why it's conveniently useful to do it that way. And additionally, when you are reading and writing and transposing as a human being, having the 0 through 9 plus A through F,
mm-hmm.
It's not that hard to read. It's actually relatively easy to see these things and read them and use them. And they're a lot shorter, right? They're
right.
shorter than they would be.
And I realize we've kind of left some people behind here, so let me give a very simple example. You were talking about colors.
Yeah.
And in your when you're dealing with colors online, especially with regard to web pages, you have red being a value from if you have an 8-bit value from 0 to 255.
A screen, a television screen or an LCD screen, actually traditionally have three different colored pixels. There's three different lights. In every single spot that could produce light, there's three colors. There's red, green, and
blue.
And so when you want to make, you know, a color show up on your screen, what you have to do is tell those pixels to produce a certain amount of intensity of each one of those colors. And you can mix any color you want. So now go ahead and describe the color, how we use hex in colors.
Okay. So I won't necessarily go that much into it. I don't want to, it's really hard to describe non-visually.
Yeah.
And I don't want to totally confound people, but it's really easy for you to recognize that if you have, you know, a zero, that's one digit, and if you have 255, that's three digits. And so to sometimes have one digit, sometimes have three digits, if you always have three digits, then you have to have 000 through, you know, it takes up space when you're trying to print it out.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if you have hexadecimal, an 8-bit value is always two characters, no matter what.
00 would be 0, and then FF is 255,
right.
256.
And so when we're looking at color values, we never have to worry about, oh, is this going to be a three-digit number or a two-digit number for what the computer needs? You always say, just use two digits. Two digits for red, two digits for green, two digits for blue. Because that hexadecimal maps to the computer space so much easier.
So in CSS, for example, for web pages, when you're talking about color, you're actually talking about hexadecimal color normally. And the way you denote that in CSS is you start with a hash. The
octothorpe.
The thing on the keyboard that is...
The pound sign.
Oh, the pound sign, yeah. Or the hashtag. And you start with that, and then the first two letters are the number in hexadecimal of the red brightness. So if it was 00, you'd have no red in the image. And if you had FF, you'd have all red you could possibly have. And then the next one is green, and the next one is blue. And if you mix any percentages of those, you get all the colors your screen can actually produce at some level.
And if you understand those colors well and how different light intensities will make different colors, then you can do stage lighting for your local theater.
That's right. Fun. So anyways, that's hex, and we talk about that because when you hash something, what you're doing is you're producing a number that you can read in hex. But let's talk about, you keep on saying signature. What do you mean by a signature of that movie you tried to download, or the signature of a picture of mine?
So if the length of that file changes, the signature changes. If you're downloading that file and there's a glitch, you know, cosmic ray came down and caused a problem.
And one bit is different.
Yeah, one of the zeros turned into a one, or vice versa. The signature changes dramatically.
That's the other thing, is that a small deviation in the input creates extremely big deviation in the output.
Mm-hmm.
It's the chaos effect, if in some ways. So that it's not like, if Miles and I were talking, we're passing a credit card back and forth. You know, there's, 12 digits in a credit card? Depends on the credit card. Mm-hmm. Phone number back and forth.
Or 16 in a credit card.
Okay, 16 digits in a credit card. So I'm reading it to him, he's listening to it, and at one point I say 0770, and he maybe writes 0070. When you read that back, there's only one little error there. It's hard for a human to see it. So if we had a hashing algorithm that created a very similar number between two different inputs, you might still miss it. You want uniqueness. You want really rough and raw uniqueness, and that's what the algorithm does.
Yes.
Now, we could process these by hand. The SHA algorithm, I'm assuming you could actually put down on paper and do it yourself, of course. But computers can do it really fast. In fact, computers can do exceptionally fast because over time, we have found so many uses for the SHA algorithm for being able to make a large thing turn into a unique small thing. And when I say unique small thing, we'll get into that in a second, but we've actually encoded this in hardware. I mean, we do this at blinding fast speeds at this point.
Right. And it's also useful for looking up. If you have a catalog of movies, and each of those movies is a couple of gigabytes in size, to go through that movie and try to find the one that you want, for example, let's say you had a library of 1,000 movies, and you had to look through the files to find the one you were looking for, so you hit play on the first one. No, that's not the one I want. That's going to take a long time. But if you take a hash of them, and then you start saying, okay, let me actually sort this by numeric order, for example, and then do the lookup, that becomes so much faster, so much more efficient that you can find the one you're looking, like know that the one you're looking for is in there or not, and then be able to do that that sideways lookup to say, okay, this hash applies to this movie. There you go.
And then, of course, you wouldn't ever have a giant bunch of movies without titles, without names, without some way to identify them. And actually, our file systems are doing that. They're just putting giant blobs of data into the disk system. We won't get into hard drives and how they work, but there has to be a lookup table. That's actually what the directory is, if you will, or the file system directory.
So
this concept of having names for things, mapping. But of course, all those names we're talking about are what we define as a name. So I might name Star Wars Episode 1 as Star Wars Episode 1, and Miles might rightly say, Star Wars Episode Destroyed My Childhood. He and I refer to the exact same title. We wouldn't know that, though, by just the titles. So if we hashed them, we had a unique value, and we compared them, and they were exactly the same, we know that our movie we just watched made us both sad. So
now, why are we talking about this?
Well, one thing was interesting about this story is that when I was an early programmer in my web, when I moved away from hardware and doing electronics and got into programming in the early web days, the first job I was hired for as a programmer, as a UI engineer, not just a web master, was a company that you worked for. In fact, you helped interview me. And one of the things you taught me about was hashes and their uniqueness. And I said to you at the time, but Miles, if I have a whole bunch of data and I make it into a small number, obviously there's multiple ways of creating that number, because if there's an infinite amount of large files, you can't reproduce them uniquely. And I think at the time you said, what? How do you describe that problem? Do you understand what I'm getting at?
Yes, and I don't know what I said then. I mean, come on.
What would you say now?
What I would say now is, in general, it is still quite difficult, because not only do you have to make another file that has the same signature, which is relatively easy, you would also, in general, have to, in order to fool someone, have a file that is the same length while having the same signature and isn't gibberish. Because in general, when we have files that are a movie, for example, if you start randomly scattering bits in there to make it so that it fits the signature, it probably won't play correctly.
Right.
When you put it into your player. Or if you have
one of the things about this that's important to understand is that 160-bit output hash is really, really big. That's a big number. It's not like you've got to say, well, you've got a number between 0 and 100, right? And every file that you have, I'm going to assign one of these numbers. Well, then you can't get hashes for more than 100 movies, or they're going to collide. They'll have the same number. We're not talking about 100 or 1,000 or 10,000. We're talking about a number so big that it doesn't even make sense to say that you'll have two copies of it made from nature, if you will.
Well, like I said, you can just randomly start flipping bits until you get there. Unfortunately, that requires a great deal of brute force.
Yes.
On the bad side, computers are becoming faster and faster, and therefore brute force becomes easier and easier.
Hence our story.
Right. Where Google found a way through extensive amounts of computing power, which is available to an outfit like Google, to make a PDF that had the same signature but had drastically different content, but both looked like legitimate documents, PDF documents. This was a lot easier with PDF because you're able to make changes within PDF, within the file format, where you can inject essentially random data without it affecting the visual output. You're able to pad the data, as it were.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, they did it. Their SHA-1, they'd been warning about this for 10 years or so.
It's deprecated, right? It's been deprecated for, let's see, it's been deprecated. It was deprecated in 2005.
Yes.
Deprecated means we don't suggest you use this anymore.
Right. Not because it had been broken then, but because they saw that we were approaching that horizon when computing power would be able to break it. And so we needed to start the migration process away from it. Which is a shame, because that's still in usage.
Right. The trick about it is that it's an easy library to grab. It's everywhere, and developers use it. And lots of times, of course, speed of hashing that the faster you can do it, the more useful it is in some ways. Because, for example, the Git source control, which we've talked about quite a bit in mm-hmm. the show over the years, it uses SHA-1 to generate unique representation of the file system. And as you change thing, it keeps signatures around. So if Miles and I make the same change to the same file and we commit it to a repo and then do a diff, we would...
Repo meaning repository.
Repository. The diff would know that they were exactly the same files because when we were creating them and making our repo and adding to them, we were actually producing hashes, SHA-1 hashes, mm-hmm. of those files. So the actual comparison is a very fast thing to do because we've already reduced the problem set. We don't have to go through character for character in the entire file.
Right. Git does it for the file that you're doing. It does a SHA-1 for the patch, the collection of files that you're making for an update. It does a SHA for the directory that the files are in, and it does a SHA-1, again, for the state of the overall repository after you've made the patch,
right.
for each revision. And so it used extensively. On the bright side...
And it works because it's really fast.
Right.
Go on.
But on the bright side, the sky is not necessarily falling with Git. They do need to migrate. But if you make a change to an existing thing in your repository and you try to push it to someone else and they have, you know, that repository as well that they're working with, it won't overwrite the old data with the new...
Right.
Simply look and say, "Oh, those SHA signatures are the same. I'm not going to copy it. I already have a copy of it."
Right. So you'd have this weird situation where if we got copies of these PDFs and I entered mine into one repo and you entered the other one into the other repo, and then we tried to commit together, whatever repo got a copy of the thing first, it wouldn't get a second copy of it. So
right.
It's this weird situation where you wouldn't be able to make a change in some way. And that's a little odd, and it's a little broken, and we'll have to migrate, but it won't corrupt the system.
Right, and if someone, it will cause a problem if someone gets a whole new copy of the,
right.
the repository. But there you're also getting into social engineering and like, but it's still not quite as bad.
Well, how much is SHA-1 used? It's used in that. It's used for confirming download stuff. What else is it used in?
Used in web certificates, so HTTPS, you know,
handshakes,
the TLS mm-hmm. certificates. And that's why most browser manufacturers have then said, we are no longer going to accept SHA-1 signatures for certs after a certain date. I believe that date
passed.
Would have been this.
There's some
either this year or 6 months ago.
Yeah, there's some loopholes for corporate environments where that was troublesome to get rid of. But yes, you're right. It's been deprecated. In fact, now when you get a cert, you don't get a SHA-1 based
right.
cert. Another one would be backup systems. This is very common mm-hmm. in backup systems. If you're using some cloud deployed backup system, what will happen is your local computer will create the backup software that runs locally will create SHAs of files and upload the file and confirm the upload with the SHA. And on the server side, they will check it and SHA. And then if you wipe completely the software from the system and run it again, the system will, and you log into your account, it'll look at the SHAs on the server and look at your local files. And as it creates SHAs, if it's already on the server, it's not going to upload the bits again. So it uses as a shortcut for detection of changes, but also for reducing the amount of transportation of data.
The other items that use it, for example, are other source control revision systems like Git, or at least nominally like Git.
Source control
would
systems.
Be, for example,
like SVN.
Subversion.
Yeah,
SVN. Run by the Apache project. That is the source control system behind WebKit.
WebKit is the web browser engine that used to be behind Chrome, but is definitely behind Safari.
Yes.
And is also behind iOS's whole implementation of web browser. If you have a web browser on an iOS device, that's WebKit.
Yes. And so, like any responsible person, when they're dealing with a potential security problem, because Subversion uses SHA-1, someone went, I wonder if I put a PDF or some other facility. Like, I think you've used that PDF as a test PDF.
I think you had to use this PDF. I mean, though we've had collisions of two different files having the same SHA, they're kind of rare. It took a lot of processing time. So Google's actually announced, and you can actually read up on this in shattered.io. Shattered.io has these PDF files that have two files with different data in the same SHA.
Right.
One.
Link is up on the website.
Yep.
Now, one of the things about the Google proof of concept is they have to show the proof of concept. Hey, here are these two PDF files, and they have the same signature. And so this person went, okay, well, let me check in one of them into the WebKit repository.
For Subversion.
And then I'm going to try to replace it with
the other one.
The doppelganger.
Uh-oh. What happened to the...
Wait, to the WebKit repository? Yeah.
That just seems like a good thing to play with.
And was wondering how that would play out. Well, you do want to test to see how it would affect you. You want to see whether or not someone could inject into your repository. If someone was a malicious actor, could they get something by you? Is there any way that you would detect it? So you want to check the front door, try it out.
Yeah.
Did not expect that by doing so, the Subversion repository completely fell over.
As in corrupted. No longer good.
Right.
Meaning
no one could use it anymore.
Was this the main repo?
Yeah.
That's horrible. That's why you don't do it that way. Wow, that's pretty bad. So it wasn't something
I think they would expect, but yeah.
This wasn't a bad actor? This was somebody actually just trying it out?
Yeah.
Wow. So they totally have they been able to recover the data?
To my knowledge, not yet.
Doesn't everybody have a copy? Oh, people don't have copies of Subversion. Like, they've had a backup.
Well, that's the thing, though, is Subversion, unlike Git, which is a peer-to-peer revision control system,
and everyone has
Subversion
copies of the entire tree,
is a client server. There's a central repository that everyone pulls and fetches and pushes to. And
that means a point of failure.
Right. And so now, how does anyone get the new data from there? Okay, can you restore from backup? I suppose, but then everyone else is on a different revision than you because they're...
Oh, man.
Yeah. It's an interesting scenario.
I mean, to be clear, this project was very hard to produce. Like, it took a lot of... When you say it took a lot of processing power, you have to have the input PDF, and you have to process it for a long time, which means you're taking some file that has some meaning to it, and you're adding and appending extra garbage in it that's not exactly garbage, it's still valid PDF, and then you're producing a secondary file. And didn't it take, like, 1,000 computing hours to do that?
6,500 years... for CPU computation. So if you took one CPU for a year, and then you take how much it can process in that amount of time, and then you multiply that by 6,500 CPUs, and then you multiply that number, and you add more CPUs so that you can whittle that down in terms of time, which for Google is not that hard.
You mean they have enough machines to make that happen in a week?
Right.
Rather than 6,000 years.
Yeah. Although what they found was when they started using GPUs for that task,
because graphic processing units,
because those tend to be are made to work with very large numbers,
sure, and in parallel,
that took 110 GPU years, which is noticeably faster than 6,500.
Oh, so this also means that people that have large systems that were working on Bitcoin mining. Those are GPU-based systems. Mm-hmm. They could write software that would run on that would do the same thing.
Yes.
So collision creation is going to be a thing that's possible with SHA-1. Okay, so you mentioned other SHAs, though, and I remember reading something about, well, we have to pay attention to the deprecated value of SHA-1 and switch to SHA-256. How hard is SHA-256 to have a collision on? It's so funny that a collision, it sounds like an accident, and that's kind of what it is. It's neat that a SHA collision is equivalent to an accident in a car. Yeah.
Well, imagine you're going to the bank and you have your signature down, and then some random person comes in and tries to write your name. The signature is going to look very different. And the question is, how can you make it so that someone who knows your signature would be able to tell the difference? With SHA-1, you have 160 bits. And SHA-256 has 256 bits, SHA-512 being 512 bits. And 256 is not, 96 bits, 96.
Bigger than 160?
Yeah, right. Times bigger. It's actually 2 to the 96 times bigger.
Right. So we're good. If we switch to 256, if we switch to SHA-256, we won't have collisions. Soon.
Well, you would, but brute force, you're not talking about
65,000 or 6,000.
You're not talking
years.
About 6,500 times 96. You're talking about 6,500 times, oh, good Lord, now I have to. 2 to the 96 is a very large number.
Yeah. You're saying 6,000 years of computing time times 2 to the 96th.
And we're talking in time scales that are longer than the age of the universe thus far.
But the point of it, though, is we do switch to that system. We will be safe for a period of time that's unknown at this point because of how processing power works, but it'll be a long time.
Right. Now, one of the drawbacks to using things like the successor to SHA-3, the 256 and the 512 versions of the updated algorithm, are that they are slower than
SHA-1. How much slower?
I don't have the graphs in front of me. I saw them a little while ago, but on the order of, if you were having something that was dependent upon the speed of SHA-1, you're going to be going, 100 times slower, at least. Which isn't a problem if you're doing, one at a time, but if you have to calculate, a certain number of SHA-1s, and the amount that you have to do on your hardware takes 3 hours, you're now looking at 300 hours, and you can no longer do it in a single day. That becomes a major engineering problem that you have to throw a lot of hardware at. On the bright side, through me seeing this story and looking at alternatives, there is the Blake 2 hashing algorithm.
Yeah, you mentioned this in our side channel, Slack chat. What is this thing? I looked at it quickly, but I didn't get if it was being adopted.
I don't know if it's being adopted. It was a finalist for the replacement for SHA-1, mm-hmm. Specifically for SHA-3. And it was about as secure as what later became known as SHA-3, which is still open for people to use. It's still a good security recommendation.
Mm-hmm.
But unlike many other algorithms, it's fast. And sometimes you don't want fast. Sometimes when you're doing a hashing algorithm of your password, for example, you don't want that to be fast. You want that to be...
We use like Blowfish, which is actually an algorithm that's memory intensive, so it goes really slow.
Or Bcrypt, yeah.
Bcrypt, yep.
Which is Blowfish using... which means you can do multiple turns as well.
And the idea being this is that if you are hashing, you're creating your uniqueness off of a password, what you want to do is be able to reproduce the uniqueness. You don't actually need to do that fast, but if anyone ever captures your database, you don't want to be able to backwards engineer what people's passwords were. Now, these hashing algorithms, even SHA-1, is not backwards. You can't go backwards with it. But what you can do is if you say, well, let's just try a whole bunch of passwords until we find one that's in the database that matches. So we'll just take a giant definition of passwords that people use and mix them up, and then SHA-1 them over and over until we find a match. Once we find a match, we know what that person's password is. That's one of the reasons why you do salting, which means you make a unique thing for every user. Mm-hmm. But SHA-1 is so quick that it's a really bad methodology for using. So instead, you use something that takes a lot of processing time, like Bcrypt. And therefore, even though for when you log in, it takes a little bit longer, through 3 seconds for a human being doesn't matter.
Although it's usually faster than that, the idea is that you can't crunch every single password out there in any appreciable length of time.
Right. Even doing it in a millisecond versus doing it in 700 milliseconds is a giant difference when you want to go fast.
Yes, absolutely. Speaking of speed, there is a side wrinkle to this, which is another reason why SHA-1 failed so badly was because there was a weakness found in the algorithm, so they didn't have to brute force 160 bits. 160 bits actually is still pretty secure. They ended up being able to do something closer to 100 bits.
And this is actually something they've known and one of the reasons why it was deprecated in 2005.
Exactly.
So there's this flaw in the way the algorithm is used that you don't actually use the entire signature length for uniqueness. You can actually process data such that you're forcing it to use a smaller subset. And that's one of the reasons why it's a two-phase attack, where you create your original file and then you create a subsequent file. You're taking advantage of that.
Okay. I did find the graph here that talks about the relative speeds. I was wrong. I overestimated by quite a bit the difference in speed. But the difference between SHA-1 and SHA-3, the 256 variant, is 3 to 1.
Is SHA-3 the 256?
SHA 3 is the specification for the next round, and then you can have the variant of SHA 3, which is 256 bits or 512 bits.
So is SHA 3 and SHA 256 the same thing?
Yes.
Okay. So just
SHA 256 is the 256 bit implementation of SHA 3. SHA 512 is the 512 bit implementation
of
SHA 3.
So it's kind of better to call SHA 256 and SHA 512 because it actually tells you a little bit more which SHA you're talking about. SHA 3 could be either.
Yes, it could be.
Okay. Speaking of speed and such, though, you said it's 100 times faster?
No, I was. That's what I was saying. I was wrong. Yeah. It's actually a 3-to-1 for SHA 256, and it is a 5-to-1, somewhere thereabouts.
Still, that's not bad. That's not a logarithmic increase in speed. It's 3 times slower. I mean, right. That's not horrible. I just recently went through a process of seeing a computer do something slow, which is rare. Like, normally when you see computers slow down, you're like, well, I wonder what's going on. My network's bad, or my hard drive's having an issue, or something like that. Quite a while for GeekSpeak, we've had an SSL cert. And we were doing one of these ones that's free from certain providers. And last week, somebody emailed in or contacted me through Twitter or something and said, hey, I noticed that you're about to expire, and Firefox or one of the browsers is having trouble with the cert you've got. And last year, I'd bunted and gotten one of these free ones again, even though Let's Encrypt has been around for a while. Because we run our own server, and setting up Let's Encrypt has some complexity to it. Not a lot. But I said, well, I've got a month out, so let me go ahead and do this now. So I started working on Let's Encrypt for geekspeak.org. We run on Nginx. We run on DigitalOcean. If you want to support us and need an instance for yourself, a server instance, you know what that means, you can help us out by going to geekspeak.org/support and using our DigitalOcean link, and I think it frees us for billing for a month or something like that. Anyway, when I first generated out doing the Let's Encrypt process that I'd found on letsencrypt.org or something, I didn't get like 5 stars, if you will, on checking the cert. You can check the certs on different locations. And the error I was seeing was that my Diffie-Hellman group was too small. One of the recommendations was the default when you do Let's Encrypt is actually 1056 or 1024 is the size of the Diffie-Hellman group. And that's actually not large enough for these kind of sites that rate whether you're secure or not.
They tend to want 4096 or at least 2048.
Yeah, 2048.
Notice these are powers of two.
Yes. So I was like, well, that's crazy. But on the DigitalOcean recommendation on what to do on their systems, they have a generate a strong Diffie-Hellman group. And so I went out, oh, let me take a look. And the reason why it's not part of the default Let's Encrypt process is it actually takes 3 or 4 minutes to run it. Mm-hmm. And that was neat to see. Like, I took my machine and just ran the command is like openssl dhparam-out and then some rate, and then you give it the length, some file direction location, then you give it the length. And it just takes a long time to crunch numbers. I'm assuming what it was doing partially is collecting chaos, if you will.
That's actually a separate thing. That's not what it's doing.
It's just looping?
It is dependent upon a random number generator that's giving as close to random as we can make it. And most of that comes from initializing the random number generator with random data, and that's usually like your mouse movements and
yeah, it didn't interact
like
and ask
spikes,
me for anything.
Like that.
Yeah, that's the chaos collection I was talking about.
But that's not part of the calculation per se.
Right.
And but yes,
entropy collection is normally what they call it. By the way, I'm calling
right.
it chaos collection.
But with most modern operating systems, when you're pulling from the random number generator, it will give you a certain amount and then go like, the pool's exhausted. And instead of giving you numbers that aren't as random, making you less secure, the operating system will actually give you back an error or at least a warning, letting you know the pool needs to be improved. You need to have more activity.
So this thing was taking a long time because it just didn't have enough entropy in the system.
Yes.
That's beautiful. I think that's wonderful. And of course, you could make hardware level entropy generators. They're not actually
People
that complicated
do.
To do. But but then, of course, teaching your operating system to use that is tricky because Apple, of course, wants my laptop to do a good job, and it can't trust necessarily the randomness of some output device. So anyway, because you could be just directing it Pi.
Yeah, it is a shame because actually newer processors do have better random number generators because they are able to deal with quantum fluctuations and then use that data to be able to get numbers because there's no possible way you could predict them. But they take money, they take resources.
Yeah, I mean, keep in mind that that you can take a diode and backwards bias it and get noise out of it. So noise is noise, right? Like theoretically. So you could produce more of it in a machine, but it's not a selling factor. It didn't used to be.
It didn't used to be. It is now.
Yeah.
It's funny. There's a side note there. You have to also make sure that that thing, that diode, for example, that leaky diode, cannot be affected by external stimuli.
Right. Because you're going to pollute the noise by adding some other pattern. And that can actually be done. These are called side channel attacks.
Yeah. So you need to have it be leaky, but also shielded.
Shielded leaky. That's awesome. So in any case, the running the Diffie-Hellman group, the way that Let's Encrypt works is you get a 90-day cert that is going to expire in 90 days. Now, if a human being was always updating a cert, which you can do with Let's Encrypt systems, always updating that every 90 days, you'd forget and it would be a problem. And in fact, you want a cert that's going to last longer than 30 days or something like that, because sometimes you'll get errors in systems that say, this cert's going to expire soon. You don't want to get annoyed like that. So the way that Let's Encrypt works is you basically, the server has a pattern that it publishes a public thing, and then the website hits that server at geekspeak.org, for example, the Let's Encrypt service does, if you will, gets that value. Then on a side channel, you say, hey, I want that, I want a cert, and the loop is done on off channel, if you will, by your machine contacting that service.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of a handshaking thing that's kind of clever. And so it's done in such a way that if you just run a cron job, which we run every Monday night for GeekSpeak, which by the way, when you're talking about security, you actually don't want to give out details like that because somebody might be able to take advantage of that. But that doesn't matter.
It does matter, but we're going to ignore that for
it
now.
Doesn't matter in the sense that there's nobody's private data besides our public website shows. Like the worst that could happen is GeekSpeak could go down or somebody could take advantage of the machine. Like there's nothing. Yeah. I'm not protecting credit cards. I'm not protecting email addresses. You know.
Right. We only have a server that could be co-opted for nefarious users.
Yeah. And I'm assuming that we would be able to detect that. DigitalOcean would be able to detect some nefarious qualities in that regard. So every Monday night, it will run a job which will re-establish a request to do this. And that process is what I actually did to generate the certs. So that process has to be relatively fast because it's two different servers communicating. And so doing that process with the Diffie-Hellman that takes 3 minutes would be a problem. And so it's not part of the default flow. You got to do it side channel. Yeah, no big deal. But it was interesting to see processing power take a long time, which you normally don't see. Getting back to SHA-1 and SHA-256 and so on, people will migrate to SHA-256. It's going to solve the problem, and it's 3 times slower. And that's not a problem? Or is that a problem?
It depends upon what your requirements are. And for a lot of people, they want something that's going to be a cryptographic hash. In other words, it's going to be something that if you have a wide variety of input, you're going to have a certain level of collisions approaching zero.
Mm-hmm.
You're never going to have zero, but approaching there. At a certain threshold, you consider it a cryptographic hash that you don't have to worry about it as much. Making a hash algorithm is actually conspicuously difficult. People don't generally just come out of university and say, hey, I'm making a secure hash. It takes years and years of practice and peer review and collaboration.
Yeah, and for example, like SHA-1, we didn't know for a long time that it actually had this flaw of having 100-bit weakness out of 160-bit output. We didn't know that for a long time until researchers figured it out, right?
10 years, yeah.
Yeah, but still. And it's impressive that it takes that long for something that people were using so much. I mean, another thing to note about this, reason why we kind of mention the fact that it's extremely hard to do is that lots of times as a software engineer, as you start working, things are like, oh, I don't know how that works. And then you go into space where you start figuring it out. And pretty soon you're like, oh, I understand that works now. And you almost can stumble into a lot of concepts in computer science. I'm a self-taught engineer.
Mm-hmm.
You're mostly a self-taught engineer. And you can do that at some level. And then there are those larger plateaus that are quite a bit of research to get to. Cryptographic hashing, encryption in general, security practices in general, are one of those plateaus where there's a lot of gotchas.
Well, it's actually less about computer science and more about
mathematics.
Mathematics.
Yeah, it's true.
Although some say computer science is a
form of mathematics.
But,
yeah, it's very...
but this is pure mathematics. Like, you don't have to know how to program at all. You can be just a strict mathematician and you can get into the field
understand these concepts.
Cryptography.
Yeah. Yeah. In any case, so we regularly say don't try to invent your own cryptography. Don't try to invent your own hashing algorithms because you'll fail miserably. And there's already ones available.
Unless you're willing to dedicate 15 years of your life towards the endeavor.
Yeah. And that produces two interesting side effects. One is that we all seem to use the same algorithms so that when there is a flaw, we all have a lot of problems at once. And the other side effect is that we, in general, are really good at this kind of stuff, like from software engineering's perspective. When you want a hash, you can get a hash. It's not that hard. And, you know, by the way, these hashes and stuff, another example of this would be it's very common to deal with a hashed user data to confirm users across systems. So, like, when you contact some web service and you get a cookie, that cookie is normally a hash of something that's being stored so that there's not data leakage, but there's still ability to confirm things. So they're used all the time. Anyway, pretty cool, and we'll be moving to 256 at some point, but the neat thing is that we did see a detected collision, and they published it, and I think that's pretty cool.
And you were asking about Blake 2, the one that I brought
up.
Yeah,
oh, sorry.
It's actually, so it's about as secure as comparable to something like SHA-3, but it is slightly faster than SHA-1. To calculate.
Wait, huh? What do you mean?
To generate the hash.
Yes.
Blake 2B, which is you can generate a digest of any size between 1 and 64 bytes.
Okay.
That runs faster than SHA-1, slightly faster.
Okay.
But it does not have vulnerabilities like SHA-1. It actually has a security profile that is similar or probably at least as secure as SHA-3.
When you say 0 to 64, it only goes up to 64 output words?
64 bytes, not bits.
Oh, okay. So big enough.
Yes.
8-bit bytes?
Yeah, 8 bits per byte, okay. Yes.
Cool. So are you thinking that, I mean, will that be the SHA-4?
No, unlikely.
Why?
It was in the running. There were aspects of SHA-3 that people thought were more useful. Maybe it was the fact that it was more easily accessible for hardware vendors. That's also a category that goes in there. How well is it easily is it implemented, especially with regard to power consumption?
Right. Because keep in mind that with SHA, you really do want as fast as you possibly can create a unique signature. Other algorithms we have, like bcrypt, are useful for slowing a machine down to deter detection. Mm-hmm. But for SHA, you want as fast as possible.
Right.
So that's going to be... So the ability for hardware vendors to be able to make it in hardware means that potentially you could speed it up by just having a subprocessor that or sub system of a chip that could do it for you.
Blake 2 is not necessarily the one that was evaluated is not necessarily the revisions that have come after. I was quoting the speed for Blake 2B.
Well, thank you, Miles, for the SHA update. When I saw the story, I was looking forward to chatting with you about it. I hope that everyone that's engineering savvy that listens to our show is fully enjoying our conversation that gets technical. I regularly think that when we get technical shows that some people are you know signing off and not paying attention, but I just spent some time with my sister, Adriana, and she, though she's a database administrator at some level, understands computers quite well. She's not an engineer, and she listens to our show regularly. So thank you for listening to those people that partially understand what we're talking about. I hope we do make sense of it for you.
Yeah, and if we're not getting technical, what's the point of the show?
At some level, that is true. Hey, if you'd like to support our program, you can go to geekspeak.org/support. You can join our Patreon, and we have many people that I will thank at the end of today's show that do give us money every month to subsidize the program and help advertise it.
I'm getting close, huh? You will go to prison.
You're going to have to catch me.
If any of you have seen the movie Catch Me If You Can, starring Leonardo DiCaprio, it was about a gentleman by the name of Frank Abagnale, who was a world-famous con man who pretended to be an airline pilot, a doctor, a variety of items, got himself into places that he should not have been allowed to get to,
did
and
he,
eventually
did
got
he
caught.
Fly, or did he just get around without flying?
He didn't fly the plane. He simply got
free flights everywhere,
pretending to be an airline pilot and just needing a ride home. So he would get onto the what they call the jump seat.
Yeah.
And hang out in the cockpit.
Right. And get free drinks.
All you needed to know was the correct lingo to make people feel like, yeah, this guy is...
Knows what he's doing.
Yeah, is one of the people that is in our group.
Frank Abagnale.
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 He is now, years later, because the exploits in the film were 50 years ago. He's a little older now.
Mm-hmm.
He was just a teenager when he did all of these things that were in the movie. He now works for law enforcement as an advisor and a consultant. How do you catch a thief with a thief? Yeah,
that's another movie, isn't it? Go on.
To Catch a Thief, yeah. And something that was interesting was he had a whole lot of his information stolen. This was part of a massive data dump from South Carolina due to healthcare records.
His personal healthcare records happened to be part of a breach.
Yes.
That he was not a part of.
Right.
Okay.
And he got a call from a TV station, local news, asking about it and asking if they knew that his identity was stolen and the like. And he hadn't heard about it yet. So
he hears from the news that his data has been.
And he says, before I make a comment, what did the state tax revenue office say? Well, the response was that they didn't. They said that they did nothing wrong, and he had a problem with that.
Wait. The state revenue office is the one that got breached?
No, the state tax revenue office would be the one that that does the audit of what was going on.
Oh, okay. So the audit of these health record systems were done by this organization, and they didn't find anything wrong.
Right.
Okay.
And he was saying, no, that's impossible, because contrary to what we think of in popular culture about a hacker, like, oh, I found a hole in this thing, and I, you know, took a virtual pipe wrench to the firewall, and now I'm in. The vast, vast majority of all exploits are because someone did not follow security policy.
Right. And this is actually someone got a disk and stuck it in their computer, corrupting it. Or they opened an attachment, or they were asked by somebody to do something.
Yeah, social engineering over the phone. Like, in this case, what they found out from a Secret Service investigation was that a government employee had taken home a laptop that should not have left the office and connected it unprotected to the internet.
So there was a flaw.
But the rule was in place that you're not allowed to do this. Somebody didn't follow the rule, and that's how the breach occurred.
Okay.
It wasn't because...
So he was right in his assessment.
Yes, absolutely. And that was important, and this is the title of the article, as a matter of fact, that you can go read up on our website from the link on Ars Technica, was... He was saying technology will not stop breaches. You cannot make technology that's going to solve a problem that we know how to solve, but human beings are involved in the chain.
Right.
And we have to be, at least until the robots take our jobs.
What you're saying is that he knew this right away, because he's been doing law enforcement kind of stuff for a while, that there was probably a fault of a human being action.
His exploits 50 years ago were also because someone didn't follow the rules. He was able to social engineer his way in there to get people to do things that were not according to what they're supposed to do.
There's actually acronyms in tech support spaces that addresses this problem directly. Things like PEBCAC. So a PEBCAC is problem exists between keyboard and chair. That's a PEBCAC. So it's a way of saying, oh yeah, that no, I solved that problem. It was a PEBCAC.
Yeah.
You're basically
or an ID10T.
What's ID10T?
If you write that out on your keyboard, write it on your screen, you will see what ID10T looks like. So exercise for yourself once you get in front of a keyboard. You can do this on your phone as well.
Kevin Mitnick, who came on our program a long time ago, he's like the famous hacker that took over the Las Vegas phone system when he was a teenager and was on the run for a while. And when you see early 80s hacker movies, Kevin Mitnick is the kid that they're representing. He went to prison for a while,
and now he's
also at some level in enforcement and security practices, and also potentially reselling stuff that shouldn't probably be sold. But in any case.
Right, and all the time he was, when we interviewed him 20 years, how long ago?
Like 15 years ago. Yeah. It's up at GeekSpeak.org, the first show that's, second or so, yeah.
He was saying, common knowledge among security researchers, which is social engineering is the way you can do a company, not through brute force attacking someone's firewall.
Right.
I mean, yes, if you have old software, you can break into a system. But if you are following good security practices, really the way you get in is not through that hard path. You know, you don't try to break down the steel-reinforced door with several deadbolts.
Right.
You go through the open window.
An example of that at the time was Blockbuster Video, and he... in his book, he talks, and it's slightly fictitious in the sense that he can't make money off of what he's been convicted of. Mm-hmm. So he tells a story that's slightly different than what actually happened, because that's the law. But his story about Blockbuster, do you recall this story?
I don't.
He talked about, you know, saying, I could probably get your credit card number right now from this restaurant. He was with somebody. I'm like, no way. He's like, yeah, well, I know you live in this area, so you probably have a Blockbuster card and in that area. So all he does is calls a different space, a different Blockbuster facility farther away than that, and says, hey, I'm with Frank, and Frank is saying to me that he doesn't have his card, but he wants this film, and I don't have his card number. And basically, over talking to an employee and talking about all the ins and outs of working at a Blockbuster
and
store.
And pretending to be a Blockbuster employee, so there's that trust level.
Yeah, and at first only asking for something simple, and then asking for something more complicated, or doing that, you know, one day with somebody else, and then 2 days later calling back with the one you really want to target. So you build a rapport with the other employees, so the employee totally trusts that you're working that business. They'll bend the rules a little bit, no problem. And that was an example that he would be able to use many times. You have to have the gumption to do that. But yeah, it's almost always the flaw as a human being, which is interesting because we always talk about the vulnerabilities in the software, the zero-day exploits. Anyway, cool. Interesting that technology won't stop breaches. Sad.
Yeah, unless you automate human beings completely out of the problem.
But then don't you have like those squid things harvesting humans?
Yes.
Or maybe you could actually teach pigeons to do it.
Can a pigeon spell security breach?
I don't know.
Can you?
Can a pigeon say...
So there are two stories that have to do with video games. One of them... I'm going to talk about is Super Smash Brothers. We've talked about chess and Go, where the computers are beating people. Well, the same thing now is happening with Super Smash Brothers.
In editing, I realized we have to have a good description. So here's my 15-year-old son, Wyatt Troxel, telling me, Wyatt, what's Super Smash Brothers?
Super Smash Brothers is a known Japanese game that is a great melee smash. It's a collection of all characters that Nintendo has created over the years, putting them together and then fighting against each other. For instance, you can have Pikachu fighting Super Mario. They even have some cool additions as Snake, and you can have Snake battle all different characters from the Nintendo universe.
What do you mean, Snake?
From Metal Gear Solid 5, or the Metal Gear Solid series, Snake is a assassin, and in the games, I think they had some relations with it, and so they added him into the game.
Wait, so I understand that Pikachu's tough and all, but that sounds not very fair.
Well, the game is sort of, they sort of balance the characters together, except in some ways, and it sort of uses the Mortal Kombat sort of, types of things, but it's more multiplayer based and you could have a lot of people, and it goes up to 9 or so
in one battle. You could have like 9 different people fighting.
Yeah, exactly.
And so at the end of that battle, is there one winner or is there a team? Are they teams?
Well, it can either be a free-for-all based game or it can be team based, and you can change that in settings and make it that way.
And you've played it before, you like it?
Yeah, I do, and definitely enjoy it.
Okay, thanks for the update.
No problem.
There was a little bit of a cheat. And when I say a little...
What cheat? What do you
mean? When I mean by a little bit, I mean a lot. The AI was reading from game memory.
So it's not using visual processing.
Right. This is not the same as when it was playing Quake and it was actually reading from this, or was it Doom? One of those. Where it was reading...
A camera was aimed at the screen. Actually, there's a whole series of games that are being beat. The old Atari games are being beat by just a camera aimed at the screen and a joystick interface.
Right.
I mean, they don't actually have a joystick. They have direct controls, but because there's no robot hand, but...
Right.
But it is visually controlled.
Yeah,
this one is actually reading from memory. So it's kind of like enhancing the autoplay feature of most games.
Right. But, you know, it still beat the best humans out there. So it's coming to the point really where...
And not by going faster than they could go. in the sense that it's not like they're modifying the memory and playing the game in a non-legal way.
Right.
Right.
It's just
human
a matter
could
of
do everything
their reaction times are faster than human beings, but that's
because we're slow meat bags.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's because it takes 80 milliseconds for us to even see something happened. And they've already reacted within that time, many times over. There is going to be a time very soon that human beings will not be able to beat any AI in any kind of video game. It's just, we're getting very close to that. So we
well,
just
keep
need to
in mind
on
that this one has problems with projectiles, and so it's useless against many Smash Brothers characters. And then it also you can like hide in a corner and it can't find you. So it's not a complete system. But what you're saying is that that's just about programming. Like,
right.
Eventually, no problem.
And in general, they're going to point it toward Donkey Kong and Pac-Man and the like and have it play the game, and it's going to get a perfect score, and they're going to really push these games so that, like, all of them have perfect scores. And it's like, okay, when a human being did it before, all these classic games where they got a higher and higher score, it was a remarkable achievement. You see what it looks like, and you're like, oh, well. Once you start having, and I had coworkers who were like this, once a computer starts doing better than the human scan, the game doesn't seem quite as exciting to try to get that highest score. The game 2048 comes to mind. I remember it's a tile game where you would shift the board left, right, up, and down to do numbers would get multiplied or added together.
Mm-hmm.
End up being powers of two. That's why it was 2048. It's a power of two. And they were competing with one another, and I had a lot of friends who were competing with one another, going like, I got this score, I got this score. And I was able to get the, 4096th tile, the higher the numbers, the
sure.
more you mm-hmm. go. And then some friends of mine at work showed me an AI that someone had written that did the game, and it was getting things like the 16,384th tile.
Right.
And people were struggling to get to 4,096, and every once in a while we get to 8,192. And so this thing was getting up to that level and higher using techniques that, human beings, like, we looked at it, and these are smart guys who love games, and like, yeah, I would never think to do that. That's insane. Yeah. You don't do that. Like,
So what you're saying is that it became unenjoyable for you because of that.
To them. To me, yeah. I found it to be a foregone conclusion. And
right, it was obvious.
Yeah,
right.
That and all of them were better than I was at the game. So,
so for you, you're like, yeah, but I'm a software engineer. So you
No. This was other software engineers who were doing this.
Oh, okay.
And in general, I just kind of took the out of saying, like, I didn't care anyway because, I was losing to you guys. So it didn't really matter if I lose to the computer as well. But
don't you think, though, at some point, you'll have all of the platform games, they'll just be beat by 100%. Donkey Kong will be a perfect game, and Pac-Man will be a perfect game by a computer, and it can do it every single time. But back in the corner, we'll just be sitting there picking and eating strawberries and winning anyway. The ability for a computer to do that, there's no joy for the computer.
Right. And so there may be joy for people to do it even though a computer is able to do it better. In much the same way that people play basketball now, even though they're never going to be as good as, the best NBA players.
Sure.
But they're still going to play because they enjoy it, not because they think they're going to be that much better.
We develop other abilities based off of systems. So, like, the way we think about numbers in general and using, like, Excel or now Google Google Sheets, we actually are able to comprehend different concepts because of those tools. So at some level, even though it's not fun to take, 7,000 numbers in an Excel spreadsheet and write them out by hand to sum them all up, instead just write equals sum parentheses A1 A7000 colon A7000 in parentheses. Doing that gives you the result, and then you can answer more complicated questions. So some tasks become ridiculous once you have a computer able to do it. I have no problem with some computer games becoming silly, like tic-tac-toe did at one point when I learned how it worked. Mm-hmm. I don't think there's any fault in the world in that way. I think that's a fine step forward.
Okay. Well, here is my prediction.
Mm.
And I'm going to try to make it easy on myself and
you
give myself...
You don't predict very often.
give myself a 15-year window, which is kind of cheating because it's way out
don't
there.
Do, yeah, okay.
It's pretty far off, especially I'm also taking into account not that the technology will be available, but that people are going to accept the technology into general use. I predict that at some point, a major professional sport is going to use an AI to referee a game.
Sure. Well, they're already kind of doing it, aren't they?
I'm talking about
full referee.
Yeah,
full control.
I'm talking about
referee a game or design a game.
Referee a game. I mean, you have someone a set of cameras all around a basketball court, and it is tracking
everything.
The person and able to make a good approximation of what their mass is like. You know, looking at their size, looking at stats, seeing what how much they weigh, mm-hmm. and what their movements are like, and watching contact with the ground able to make perfect calls about whether or not something was a foul, whether it was charging, whether or not they traveled or not.
But won't that produce at some level the game? Won't the game change to be designed to do what the computer can't referee?
But see, that's what I'm thinking. Right now, referees do get based upon intuition. There is some bias with regard to players that has been fairly well documented. If you don't know about this, Google Michael Jordan traveling. You'll see some wonderful six-step motions that don't get called.
Why?
There are different theories. One of them being that the superstars get preferential treatment.
Because they're amazing.
Because they're amazing.
Okay, okay.
There may be some.
First off, you're saying 15 years?
Yeah.
Why that long? So you can make sure to be right?
Because the technology will show up to do this. And
you're
I think it'll be especially useful for finding flops.
But wait, let's first off, pick a sport. Let's do basketball. Let's do NBA games.
Okay.
So you're saying that at some point, NBA games will be reffed by machines.
At least in terms of I don't know that it'll be in general, but it would be for specific games like maybe the All-Star game or something along those lines.
Okay, so let me ask you this, though. In an industry like this where there is a lot of money involved and there are, you know, referees unions, don't you think that they'll still be like the human referees will decide to use the data or not, and they'll just slowly use into it? Or do you think the team owners will get together and make a rule set that they can get rid of refs? Like, which way do you think it'll actually play?
I think the technology will improve where it will become some part of the analysis for referees to begin with. And at a certain point, people are going to start looking at that data and seeing how it deviates from the ref's calls when they're not doing a review.
Right.
And going to see, like, I'm seeing a discrepancy, and the computers are doing a better job than the refs. Let's try it out. And the resistance is going to be from people that want it to be that human fudge factor.
I think that you're underestimating the time, because keep in mind that automated cars will get on the roads, and everyone will start trusting AI to be really much better than human beings, because human beings will keep killing people and robot cars won't. And you'll get this large impact on trust. You might get a backlash of people losing their jobs because of, you know, automated things. But I think that relatively soon we will trust computer judgment more than we will human judgment.
Except that no one dies if the ref makes a bad call. So there is no incentive on that line of people are going to die if they have self-driving cars or not.
Right. But if – keep in mind that the camera feeds – are already there, and it's the television companies that are rebroadcasting, right? The networks that are broadcasting, they already can start doing that perfectly, right? So they could start doing 3D renderings and mass analysis of everything that's going on, and they'll have that data and know if the ref is wrong or not, and they'll make fools of the ref when they have the data that's right.
Yes, but you will, I think, start seeing a push for referees being akin to the players, that we don't want to
lose
human beings out of that loop.
Yeah, well,
and that's going to be the pushback, the back and forth about whether or not the referees are an integral part of the game or whether they are staff that's, okay. that's added on.
That... Cool. So we talked about Smash Brothers. We went into actual game analysis. You have a second computer game story about consoles, yes?
Yes, which is the video game industry, which is the Entertainment Software Association. It's a trade organization, including Sony, Microsoft, Nintendo, you know, the big ones that make
ones,
the
yeah.
PlayStation, the Xbox, the Wii. They are pushing to oppose a bill in Nebraska called the Right to Repair Bill. Which
What is the Right to Repair Bill? It sounds like giving humans the ability to repair things they own.
Right. Electronics, as they come to an end of life, you know, so no more cartridges are being sold for them. The consoles necessarily aren't being sold anymore. What happens if they break? Right now, there's a lot of... protection with regard to showing the specs of how it's built, and
there aren't schematics available, and extra chips being provided by the manufacturers of these devices.
Right.
You're talking like an original NES or something.
Yeah, or even a Nintendo 64. Or I mean, not a Nintendo 64. Atari 2600 was what I was thinking, but Nintendo 64 works as well. That people would have the right to go in and make changes to their system to either fix a flaw or to make it better. Like, everything has flaws. What happens if someone can go in and fix that flaw, or they go in and make a change so that it would accept not copy-protected media, DRM-protected media, and then start playing other games or making modifications so that it's not reading from an optical player. It's now reading from a hard drive storage unit, you know, or
having all the games ever made for that console available.
Yeah. Exactly. And that's their concern, or at least their stated concern. But it does bring up that thing we've talked about on a regular basis, which is, do you own the things that you get? Do you own that console, or are you renting it? Do you own that game? Do you just have a license to it?
And a complication of this is the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, which kind of says that if you make a rule that can break the protection of the system, then you're infringing that law.
Right. The PlayStation 3
The scenario of this? Are the video industry against it?
The gaming industry, is largely against it. They don't want to have it. They want to restrict the repair options to places that they certified as being authorized repair centers. And
what's the rationale for them? I mean, if you have a system that's 10 years old, why does it matter from their bottom? They're not going to make very much money off of it anyway, even if they are going to charge on repairs and stuff. What do you think it is? Just gut reaction. What do you think it is?
I think it's not wanting to have their systems modified in ways that they don't find appropriate. It's a control issue.
But why does it hurt their business model? Is it the possibility that people will learn more about their systems and break the more current ones? I mean, or is it they just want to get those systems offline so that people are playing their new systems?
Their position is that the repair could be potentially unsafe.
That's just crap.
That the repair could cause cybersecurity problems. That if you're patching something, that you may inadvertently open yourself up to
those
hold,
companies
really
don't care about the people. That's
but really that has to do with hacking away into being able to play a game when you haven't really
paid for it. So they're fighting against it so that people don't duplicate the content.
And that's really what they say. They're worried that the repair could lead to intellectual property theft.
Pretty weak. I hope they lose. GeekSpeak is a registered service mark of David Lawrence and is used with permission. And GeekSpeak is Creative Commons Attribution 3.0. Use our stuff any way you'd like. You can even make money off it. Just give us some credit. I want to thank Michael Newman of Pet Star Music for our lovely theme song. And I'd also like to thank Greg Merkley, who titled this week's show, Pigeons Hire Robots to Hash Uber. And now I would like to thank our awesome patrons. Thank you, Chris Irwin and Pat Hedder, for participating in an amazing level of supporting our program for quite a while now, every month. Thank you so much. And also Jerry Devine, Jim Warner, Glenn Nelson, John Winston, Alex Chen, Narajas Clenius, and Tim Ramsey. Thank you so much for contributing and allowing us to thank you on air.
Also, a thank you to the 19 other individuals who contributed to GeekSpeak who did not want to be named on air. You are still very much appreciated.
For January of 2017, we had 28 patrons pledging $142, which, of course, we are using for marketing and for covering our costs. Miles, let's do some post-show. You've got two more stories?
Just one that I wanted to do specifically. My horror and shock, hearing about the murder of Garmin employee Srinivas Kuchibotla and Alec Madasani, although Kuchibotla was killed, Madasani was wounded. And I cannot express how disappointed I am in our country that this type of violence occurs, and that it was perpetrated by an individual, a white male. He believed them. These are both gentlemen who were from India, and he believed them to be Middle Eastern, which, if there were Middle Eastern, it still does not excuse the action one iota. It is an expression of hate that I cannot...
And one witness actually said that he yelled out, "Get out of my country."
Yes.
When shooting them. So definitely a hate crime.
Yeah, and this climate that we find ourselves in of anti-immigration is toxic. And the fact that it has occurred to technical workers, you know, does bring a personal note to it just because we are in this industry.
Garmin, of course, is the GPS company,
yes.
Right?
Yes. Yeah. But it is one that I don't... I mean, it could happen to anyone in any industry, but specifically in tech industry, because there is so much immigration having to do with that that's been publicized in the media. It does make things more personal because they could have been any of the number of people that I have shared an office with over decades. And in addition to that, as a personal note, I know that, for example, when I've crossed a border and people have questioned me, you know, when I've gone on flights, I personally, as a person who is of mixed race, African-American and white, people have looked at my skin complexion and overall curliness of hair and like and assumed that I was Middle Eastern. I've been told that I look like someone from Morocco. That if I went there and did not speak, that I would be indistinguishable from the general populace, which that makes me somewhat uneasy, knowing that if he was going to fire on someone that he believed to, that to my eyes go like that person's Indian or Pakistani, and then say they're Middle Eastern and worthy of attack, that I would be a target as well, just based upon my appearance. And I do want to bring some recognition to the man Ian Grillot, who, or Griot, I don't know if he's pronounced it the French pronunciation or not.
Sure.
That is another white male, but he saw what was going on with the other men, and he came forward trying to prevent the attack. Tried to minimize, you know, tried to help the two men who were being assailed and was himself injured
as well,
although he will recover. There are GoFundMes for all three gentlemen, and I encourage anyone to spend some time at that site and try to help out. And I have nothing but sorrow and a profound regret about the state of our country, especially with regard to Srinivas's widow.
Yeah.
Jeez. Everything that has been reported in the story have been that both of them were wonderful people who, I mean, no one deserves this, but especially people who have brought nothing but optimism to other people's lives. It makes it doubly painful in many ways.
I might have mentioned this on the program before, but I have a close friend, and he and his wife work here under his work visa, and they might have to leave the country because the scenario of work visas are getting stricter, and they're in a small slot that's available to them. She works as well, but if the process changes, she won't be able to work under his work visa, potentially, and they'll have to go. And, you know, they're thinking about selling their house, and it's just this kind of shock that, you know, 6 months ago or a year ago, we were all excited about it being able to buy a place and how things were working on, you know, staying in the country. And it seemed to be this completely intelligent thing to be happening. I mean, keep in mind that, like, the profession that he does, we're constantly trying to hire people like that. It is a very difficult role to fill in the sense that it's a very competitive market. So it doesn't feel like there's any downside of having these two really educated and amazing people and staying in the country. But they're considering just selling their home in case, because why risk it, kind of thing, you know? Of course, this, you know, a shooting is like the epitome of evil in this regard, being obviously the firmament has been drawn up by the way our media talks about people. And anyway, we don't do this much, but we're in the post show, huh?
Yeah, and there's part of me that wanted to do this in the regular show, and I worry just as right now that I'm rambling.
Yeah,
and I don't know how
to highly educate in this space, right? Though you, I mean, I don't know. I feel like, and I read a lot of what you put on Facebook, and I do get that you are very thoughtful in this space. We don't normally talk about it on air, if you will.
I thought it was worthy of comment. I didn't know how to work it into the show.
Yeah.
If anything, I feel like this discussion deserves a venue in and of itself.
Yeah, I agree.
I
don't have time to start another podcast. I'm sorry. In 2000, you know, to be clear in this story, there's another part of this. In 2015, Garmin got approval from the Olaf City Council to expand its headquarters in hopes of doubling its 2,700 employees headcount. And Hamilton, who is a pastor in the nearby community of Leawood, told The Verge that there is a fear of the other that has been exacerbated during the election. And he also said that some of the engineers employed at Garmin were part of the changing face of the community, and that, you know, as Garmin grew and people came in that were not like people that grew up down the street, there was tension that emerged. And the diversity is increasing, but it's small but growing. And clearly, this is going to turn that back in every single way, this kind of shooting. It's very sad. You got anything positive to say about the world and acceptance?
About the world, that there's a resistance, that there are a large number of people who find this to be horrible, that Srinivas's family has already raised 160,000 that I'm aware of, although from a strictly monetary point of view, I mean, he was in the tech industry, so I mean, that will only go so far compared to what it is. And you can't really put a dollar amount on the loss of someone you love.
Yeah.
At the same time, I mean, there has been a support there, and it has been getting press. Getting press after the fact just isn't enough.
No.
Like, how do we give more empathy to our fellow human being before the problem occurs? I mean, talking about immigration is one thing, but stoking the fires of xenophobia is really, irresponsible.
Mm-hmm. All right, I guess that's it for this show. Episode 8 of season 17. I think I'm going to go crawl into a hole and cry.
Well, we did warn you. The regular show was over. You don't know what you're going to get when you go into the after show.